Penguin Random House Audio presents The Life of Milarepa by Tsangnyön Heruka. Translated by Andrew Quintman. Introduction by Donald S. Lopez, Jr. Read for you by Lee Osorio. Introduction. The Buddhism of Milarepa. In his 80th year, as the Buddha was about to pass into nirvana, he told his disciples that after his death, they should cremate his body and then build a stupa, a reliquary, at a crossroads, explaining that those who visited his stupa and venerated his relics would be reborn in heaven. After his passage, his body was duly cremated. But a dispute arose among his lay followers over who should receive the remains, and so the Buddha's relics were divided into 8 portions and distributed among the various groups. The ashes from the pyre made a 9th object of veneration, and the bucket used to apportion the relics made a 10th. Thus not 1, but 10 stupas were erected. Not long after the Buddha's death, one of his chief disciples overheard a monk expressing relief that the Buddha was no longer around to scold the monks. Aghast at the sentiment, the disciple convened an assembly of 500 monks in a cave on Vulture Peak, outside the city of Rajgriha, the site of many of the Buddha's most famous sermons. The purpose of the assembly was to recite what the Buddha had taught, both his discourses as well as the code of monastic discipline. First to speak was Ananda, the Buddha's cousin and personal attendant. He had spent more time with the Buddha than any other monk, and the Buddha had promised to repeat to him any discourse he had delivered on those occasions when Ananda was absent. Ananda was also renowned for his prodigious memory. At this first assembly, Ananda was called upon to recite everything he had heard the Buddha teach. He began the recitation of each discourse with his personal testimony. "Thus did I hear." All texts that purport to be the word of the Buddha begin with this famous phrase. A consideration of the Buddhism of Milarepa, as presented in the biography translated here, might begin by noting that the first chapter of the text starts with the phrase, "Thus did I hear," and that it ends with a dispute over Milarepa's relics. These are clear signs that Milarepa was regarded as a Buddha by his lineage, and that the author of the biography, Tsangnyön Heruka, made effective use of the tropes of Buddhist literature in the composition of the biography. The story of the distribution of the Buddha's relics and the opening formula of a sutra are renowned among all the Buddhist traditions of Asia. A Buddhist sutra begins with, "Thus did I hear," and then names the place where the Buddha was residing and who was seated in the audience at the time of the discourse. But here, the Buddha is absent. Or perhaps more precisely, Milarepa is the Buddha. The scene is not Vulture Peak in India, but Belly Cave in Tibet. And the members of the audience are not the famous monks and bodhisattvas of Indian Buddhism, but Milarepa's Tibetan disciples, joined by some local Tibetan deities. The implication of the scene is that there was the Indian Buddha, Shakyamuni, there was Padmasambhava, the Indian tantric master who brought Buddhism to Tibet in the 8th century, sometimes referred to by Tibetans as the second Buddha, and there is Milarepa, a Tibetan Buddha born and enlightened in Tibet, without going to India or receiving the direct instructions of an Indian master. One of the standard elements of the Mahayana sutras is for Shakyamuni Buddha to praise a Buddha who resides in another universe, telling stories of his former lives as a bodhisattva, describing the glories of the Buddha field, or pure land, that he inhabits. In the biography of Milarepa, his disciple, Rechungpa, 1084 to 1161, has a dream in which he finds himself in what seems like a pure land, with buildings made of precious stones and inhabitants dressed in fine brocades. The place is called Odiana, Garden of Dakinis, indicating that it is a special place for tantric practice. Odiana in northwest India was considered by Tibetans to be the birthplace of Padmasambhava, and the place of origin of many important tantric texts and lineages. In this sacred place, Rechungpa is invited to attend the teachings of Akshobhya, imperturbable, the Buddha of the East. As Shakyamuni so often did, the Buddha Akshobhya recounts the lives of other Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. He concludes his discourse by saying, "Tomorrow I shall narrate the life story of Milarepa, which is even more excellent than those I have just described. So come and listen." The members of the audience leave the discourse wondering where the Buddha Milarepa might reside. Perhaps it is Abharati, the eastern Buddha field of Akshobhya himself. Perhaps it is Akanistha, the heaven that is the eighth and highest level of the realm of form, Rupadhatu. And according to many Mahayana texts, the abode of the enjoyment body, Sambhogakaya, of the Buddha. Rechungpa knows, however, that Milarepa is in neither place, but is rather in Belly Cave, just a few feet away from where he is sleeping. Rechungpa's dream introduces a theme that runs throughout the life of Milarepa, that there are two parallel universes, one profane and one sacred. In one, Milarepa is an impoverished beggar living on nettles in a cold and barren cave. In the other, he is a highly advanced yogin, practicing blissful sexual yoga with beautiful goddesses. In one, Marpa is a cruel and greedy drunk, demanding payment in exchange for his teachings. In the other, he is a compassionate Buddha capable of purging the sin of multiple murder from his disciple. In one, Milarepa is a dangerous sorcerer to be avoided at all costs. In the other, he is a kind teacher willing to teach all who approach, even his evil aunt. In one, Milarepa is a murderer. In the other, he is a Buddha. Much of the story is concerned with the failure of those in the first world, beginning with Milarepa himself, to perceive the second. After he becomes aware of the sacred world, Milarepa's compelling songs are often intended to shift his listeners' perceptions from one world to the other. As Rechungpa's dream intimates, Milarepa occupies both worlds, suggesting that ultimately, the two domains are one. Buddhism arrived late in Tibet. The Buddha lived and taught during the 5th century BCE. And in the centuries after his death, his teachings were carried by his monks over most of the Indian subcontinent and north into what is today Kashmir, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. In the 3rd century BCE, Buddhism spread to the island of Sri Lanka, then to China in the 1st century CE, to Southeast Asia in the 3rd century CE, to Korea in the 4th century, to Japan in the 6th century. Buddhism did not enter Tibet until the 7th century, its influence initially limited to the royal court. The first monastery was not established, and the first Tibetan monks were not ordained until the late 8th century. A brief period of generous royal patronage for Buddhist institutions and for the translation of Buddhist scriptures from Sanskrit into Tibetan followed. But this was cut short by the death of a pious king in 838 and the succession of his brother, who persecuted Buddhism. This began the so-called Dark Period, in which Buddhism, and especially monastic Buddhism, declined across the Tibetan domain, remaining in the shadows for more than a century and a half. Buddhism returned in the 11th century, its renaissance sometimes marked retrospectively by three events. The first was the return to Tibet of Rinchen Sambo, 958 to 1055, a monk dispatched to India by the king of Western Tibet at the age of 17. He would spend the next 17 years abroad, most of them in Kashmir, returning as a skilled translator of sutras, tantras, and their commentaries. The second event was the arrival of the great Bengali monk, Atisha, 982 to 1054, who came to Western Tibet in 1042 at the invitation of the local king. He spent the remainder of his life in Tibet, composing his most influential work there. The third were the journeys of Marpa the translator, 1012 to 1097, from his home in southern Tibet to Nepal and India, where he received the initiations and instructions that he would pass on to Milarepa. There were other important figures, but these three, two monks and one layman, two Tibetans and one Bengali, each contributed to different elements that were central to what Tibetan historians call the later dissemination, Chidar. Among the 157 text translations credited to Rinchen Sambo, there are many tantras and tantric commentaries.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.